Good morning. Welcome to this place we call church. As I like to say, it is a special day. Every Sunday morning is special. We have the chance to see the smiles, to share about our week, but also to open our hearts and hear the message of God. An opportunity to learn, to grow, and share. So welcome to First United Methodist Church of Pittsfield.
This morning, we have a few announcements. If anyone has a prayer that they would like to include, there are cards in the back in the narthex. You're welcome to fill out a card and put it in a basket if you wish. Also, whenever we sing, if you can please wear your masks, we'd appreciate that. Enjoy your time here.
Copies of the minister plan in the narthex. So if you didn't get one, you can have one, you can read it, and please, you can share with me or anyone who's part of the church council your concerns, questions, or inputs about this proposal. Brother Jim Brunson, our church council chair, will be sharing some updates on construction.
Hey, good morning, everyone. From behind you, so I see what you're really thinking. So, good morning. I wanted to share just a couple of fast updates for you to understand the crazy progress or lack thereof of, to our right, the new entry and the sidewalk. Long story, very boring and very short. Mr. Pariseau and me lately have been engaged in a long battle with the city of Pittsfield over what a sidewalk is, over what a ramp is, and over this, that, and the other thing. Finally, on Wednesday, the city said, okay, mea culpa, fine, please go ahead and build what you got. It just involved an awful lot of back and forth with our architects, our contractors, and our beautiful city administration. Not to give them a hassle, like you're just trying to do their work, but they they are the sole reason we are 2 months behind schedule on this job. We didn't want you to think it was for lack of interest or lack of work on the church's behalf. It's just been a bureaucratic nightmare. So, to wrap up, the update from our carpenter is he will begin work here Monday or Tuesday to do like the new doorways, even if there's a temporary one. He'll finish the decking, anything outside, painting, staining, bringing in vinyl treatments, that kind of stuff. We should be pouring concrete, I hope, next week, and with any luck, in the next week, if not 2 weeks max, we have that entry finally up and running like it's supposed to be. Then the ladies who wanted to landscape it, I don't know what, Susan, 3 months ago, can finally start working on that, and we'll begin with the rest of our projects. But if you have any particular questions, please see John or I, and hopefully the next time we see you, that thing is done or darn close. Thank you, and have a good morning.
Thank you, Jim, for the updates. And it is important for us to understand that sometimes, especially regarding construction, we do have steps, and it is a process that we need to deal with, permits and architect projects, and also all of the details regarding the construction itself. So it is a process, and as we shared last week, rebuilding something is always difficult. Please join me in the opening prayer. Dear God, thank you for your amazing power and work in our lives. Thank you for your goodness and for your blessings over us. Thank you that you are able to bring hope through even the toughest of times, strengthening us for your purposes. Thank you for your great love and care. Thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you that you are always with us and will never leave us. Thank you for your incredible sacrifice so that we might have freedom and life. Amen.
Please stand if you're able. Great is the Lord, he is holy and just. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord, he is holy and just. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice.
Please stand for the gospel reading. Today's reading is from Mark. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless their hands are a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating food with their defiled hands?" He replied, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. You have to let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions. Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person.
And glory in
Friends, our scripture this morning is from second book of Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as a Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. The word of God for the people of God. Friends, we all know that changing a habit, it's a very difficult task. Especially because some habits become values. Habits, it's something we do to create balance and order in our daily routines. They can go from hygiene habits to addiction. So we have good ones and we have bad ones. So sometimes spiritual practices can become weekly, daily habits. Routines created to have balance between spirituality and ordinary life. And some people know how to differentiate one from another. Spiritual practices and personal habits. But some other people, they just don't. And there is nothing wrong if our spiritual practices become habits. The problem is when they become just a habit, not a practice. One of the most difficult aspects of changing anything in church is the possibility to make distinction between a habit and a spiritual practice. And just to give you more clarity on these two, a habit is something I do to keep things in place and make me feel stable. The right time to eat is an example. And my girls know that if it's time for lunch and I don't eat, my mood gets bad. You have the same problem? Yeah? So friends, certain habits are difficult to change just because they are the way how we organize our minds and routines. But as I said at the beginning, sometimes they become values. So now let me tell you something about spiritual practices. They are not like habits. You don't need them in the same way every single day at the same time. But instead, a spiritual practice is something I do to create something new, to experience something different, something special. And somehow the second letter of Paul to the church in Corinth, it's to explain the differences between spiritual practices and personal habits. Of course, the central theme of this letter is the relationship between suffering and the power of the Holy Spirit in Paul's apostolic life, ministry, and message. For strange reasons, people were questioning Paul's authority as an apostle. Just because they transformed spiritual practices into personal habits, they created a culture, and anything that could happen outside that culture would not be accepted. So they created the sense that an apostle is someone who walked with Christ during his ministry, someone who walked with him physically speaking. So people were questioning Paul's authority as an apostle just because he was not there with Christ, being part of the 12 disciples. So every time we create a culture in terms of religion, we can transform this into a habit, and then we become difficult to negotiate, to think something different, to experience something different. So because of this culture, they could not understand the transformational ways God was working in and through Paul's life. So he had to write to this church and say, I am an apostle. I have the same authority as the other 12 to share and preach the message. It is not because I was not there physically with Christ that I don't have the authority to preach the message. He was trying to break down this spiritual understanding that became a culture, a religious habit among Christians. And let me tell you something about religious habits. They can easily become evil. When they are not negotiable. Another thing that I want to share about is that religious practices are not always spiritual practices. And here's a third one. Religious habits can blind those who always think, we have been doing this for a long time. Why changing? Instead of thinking, what can be done? No, different, to perfect this. And I think this is the conflict between Paul and the church in Corinth. Because Paul was trying to preach something different. He was trying to help and guide and lead this church, these people, to understand that God, it's not in a box. But they could not understand that just because they created this culture that an apostle is someone who walked physically with Christ during his ministry. So now we come to a very important part of this scripture when Paul is saying the God of this age is blinding people, is blinding those. Who cannot see the light of Christ. And sometimes we have the wrong interpretation about this verse because we think that Paul is talking about the devil. Some people, they associate the expression the God of this age to the personification of the devil, Satan. But this is not what Paul is talking about here. The God of this age that Paul is talking about, it's a deification, a personification of things that can block us of experiencing a transformational life in Christ. And this can be wealth, power, sometimes human wisdom, knowledge, and sometimes religious habits. All of these things can become an issue for us to develop a spiritual life. So, friends, who or what are we worshiping? Am I able to identify anything in my religious life that needs to be changed? Also, what type of vision do I have as a Christian? How do I see the church and worship service as a religious practice or a transformational spiritual practice? So what is wrong with us? Is anything wrong with us? The message we preach or the messengers we have? What is wrong with the church? And why I keep saying this? What is wrong with us should be a confessional question. A transformational question in our daily spiritual practices. Maybe because of my first degree in philosophy, I always have questions. And here's one question, a big question I have about the church. We preach about love. We say that spiritual life is important. We help those marginalized. We preach that God loves all. But people don't want to be here. Why? It's a beautiful community. Look at your pastor, a handsome pastor, blue eyes. With this poetic Latino accent. But why people don't want to be here? As I said, I don't have answers, but I do have many questions. And here's another one. Should we stop blaming society, politics, and secularization and start blaming the church?
This message, it's not about guilt. This message, it's about reflection and transformation. This message, it's not about saying we're doing everything wrong. This message, it's about we can do better. This message, it's not about there is nothing we can do because this is the way we do things. But this message, it's about what can be done to see just this church reconnecting with the community in a way that we can grow. Friends, I believe it is time to fight against evil within the church. I think it is time to start discerning if we are worshiping God and therefore seeking for transformational experiences, or worshiping our tradition and saying, I don't want to change because this is what I think it is right. I don't care if it's not working, this is what I think it's right. We might be divided as the church in Corinth was. Divided in opinions, ideas. But at this point, as a church, we need to put these differences aside and start working together for the sake of the mission. So, the way how Paul explains to this church about the God of this age, every time I read it, every time I'm studying this part of the scripture, I keep thinking, what is the God of our age? And sometimes I think that the God of this age is religion. Let me say this. You probably know that, I hope it's working. Yes, it is. You know the word religion comes from Latin, religare, and means reconnecting. Reconnecting human beings to God. So the concept about religion, it's a good concept, it's a good idea. But when it comes to practice, it's a different thing. Just because sometimes we do not understand that we need to fight any form of evil. And sometimes, in church, in our practices, we distort them. And this is common. We do that, including pastors. And we need to be reminded of this word, religion, the meaning of it, that we were called to share a message in a way that people can be reconnected with God. So what I want for this church, it is not being here every Sunday and doing the same thing. What I want for this church is a transformational experience. We are in a process of discernment. And as I said last week, I have been preaching the same message since I came here. And why? Just because in this time of transition, it is good to invite people to think with me. It is important to think together and evaluate, and create new perspectives, and create a lot of questions. Because questions are important, and questions and doubts are part of our faith development. Do you know that? There's nothing wrong about having questions. They are the way all the questions and doubts you have about church, spirituality, God, Bible. All of them, all of these questions are important to find your own way to grow your faith. So Paul is telling this church, we are here to heligare, to reconnect, to help people see God, to help people open their eyes and see the light of Christ in their lives. That's our purpose. We are not here to discuss any religious culture about my authority as an apostle, but we are here to build a kingdom, not our kingdom, but the kingdom of God, where everyone is welcomed. Let us pray. God, here we are before you. We might have different opinions about politics, about any social issue, but we want to be together as a community to fulfill our mission. Help us, God, help us in this journey so we can open our eyes and we can see the light of Christ, and we can fight evil and we can be open for the work of your Holy Spirit. We pray for this church, we pray for our leadership, we pray for Harvest the Table ministry, we pray for the projects and the plans and the ideas we have, and we pray that your guidance through the Holy Spirit help us understand your plan for us. That's our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
This one's probably new to a lot of you.
Oh, 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 Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. My Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm.
Again.
Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. My Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm. No one can do like Jesus, not a mumbling word he said. He went walking down to Lazarus' grave and he raised him from the dead. Is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. My Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm. When Jesus was on earth, the flesh was very weak. He took a towel and girded himself, and he washed his disciples' feet. Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. My Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm. Yonder comes my Savior, him whom I love so well. Yeah. more time. Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land, a weary land. My Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm.
Thanks, Joshua. You may be seated. Friends, before praying together, we'll be praying for our young Christians. They're going to college. So I want to call Lara, Raquel, and Micaiah. I don't know if we have anyone else who is starting college this year. And I'd like to invite Reverend Craig, if he can come and pray for these young people. Yeah, come forward. So we can pray for them. You see, it's not easy to raise twins. So I'm now finally free.
Let us join together in prayer. Oh God, you are a God of transition and of new things. We pray for these young folks who go off on a new venture. We pray that you will continue to guide them and lead them, help them not only in their studies, but in their growth in wisdom and power and might, and also in faith. Be with them and know that they are surrounded by your love as well as the love of this congregation, that they are the people that have been nurtured in your bosom and in the heart of the church. Continue to show them ways in which they can reflect your love that they have experienced in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And remember, this is just the beginning. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. This is the contemporary version, but you are welcome to pray in another version or language. Our Father in heaven, help us to honor your name. Come and set up your kingdom so that everyone on earth, we obey you as you are obeyed in heaven. Give us our food for today. Forgive us for doing wrong as we forgive others. Keep us from being tempted and protect us from evil. Amen.
Once again, if anyone has any prayers that they would like to include in the offering this morning, the ushers will come down and you can place them in the baskets. Our prayer for this offertory. Generous giving God, we offer our gifts to you in gratitude for all the blessings you rain down upon us. Your sunshine warms us, your earth feeds us, and your word nourishes us. More than these gifts of money, we give ourselves, our time, and our energy, that we might be doers of your word and not just hearers only. We pray this in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen.
Christ has broken down the wall. Christ has broken down the wall. Let us join our hearts as one. Christ has broken down the wall. We're accepted as we are. We're accepted as we are. Through God's love, all is reconciled. We're accepted as we are. Cast aside your doubts and fears. Cast aside your doubts and fears. Peace and love freely offered here. Cast aside your doubts and fears. We will tear down the walls. We will tear down every wall. God has called us one and all. Christ has broken down the wall. Christ has broken down the wall.
May the love of God, our Father, the grace of Jesus Christ, the Son, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with us, guiding us and helping us in this journey, opening our eyes and strengthening us in this moment of transition and growth and discernment. Amen. Have a great week. God bless you.